Great. Welcome, everyone, to the Game of Thrones session, which is Taver versus Saver. I think whoever has the dragon will probably win this one. So I'm Alan Young, and I'm co-moderating this with Professor Alan Cribier. And the panelists include Vinnie Papart, Dr. Chime, Dr. Cohen, Dr. Grube, Dr. Kim, and Dr. Park, and Dr. Popmer, and Dr. Yin. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our speaker. The first speaker is our master of the masters, Dr. Alan Cribier. He's going to talk about the 20th anniversary of Taver's ceremony, from concept to human application.
Hello. Good afternoon to everyone. My dear friends, I'm sorry for those who know the story as well as me, but I will tell it again. So, well, I would like to give you a few slides concerning this long 20-year adventure of developing Taver from concept to human application. This is my disclosure. So first of all, you know, there is a question that I have very often to answer. You know, why did Tavi was born in Rouen, France, and not somewhere else? So first of all, because I had a very special journey, and I had very, very outstanding mentors. You know, I had my medical studies in Paris in the top level cardiology and cardiac surgery department in Paris with the big names at this time. And then I had my residency in Rouen, France. It's 120 kilometers northwest of Paris. And I met Professor Brice Le Tac, who has been my boss for many years. And I succeeded to him when he retired. And he was very open to research, innovation, and so on. He has been supporting me all the time. And also, he had a great idea to send me to Los Angeles at the Cedars-Sinai Medical Center. And then I have been working in 76 and 77 with Jeremy Swan and Willy Gantz, you know, these great innovators. And they transmitted to me the virus of innovation, innovative technology. And when I was back to Rouen in 77, you know, I was full with the idea that I would be able to detect the clinical needs, and I presumptuously admitted that I was able to solve some of them. So my head was full of those. And they taught me to never give up, and I understood that perseverance is the key words for any innovation, especially in medicine. So also, I had the chance of working with a wonderful supportive dream team that you can see here on the screen. And especially, I could build a fantastic partnership with the cardiac surgeons. So the cardiac surgeons were on my side all the time, and this was absolutely exceptional. And also, I had some great fellows like Hélène Elchaninoff, who was my right arm during the development of TAVR, and she is now leading the department after me. So development of technological innovation in the field of acquired aortic stenosis, I had two. You know, I started 35 years ago with developing balloon aortic valvuloplasty. This was my first attempt, with the first in man done in 85, published in The Lancet, and then I moved to transcatheter aortic valve with the first case in April 2002, 20 years ago, more than 20 years ago. And, you know, it's the same research program on innovation in the field of acquired aortic stenosis, with the same goal for this two-linked innovation, trying to find a therapeutic option for patients with symptomatic AS and turned down for surgical valve replacement. And this was a real problem. You know, in the years 2000, for example, it has been shown that almost one-third, between one-third and half of the patients were never operated on, even when they were symptomatic, and the mortality rate of this patient was extremely high, you know, 80% at 2 years. And when I started being involved with the project, you know, surgery was declined to all the patients older than 70 years of age. So it means that one out of two patients in my department were dying without the possibility of doing anything for them. And so it was an attempt to solve a major unmet clinical need. So first of all, I tried to dilate the valve, and this was the first in man balloon aortic valvuloplasty in 85 on a lady who was extremely symptomatic. And in spite of using a relatively small size balloon, you know, she survived 2 years without any symptoms and she returned to normal life. It was absolutely amazing. So we did a first series of patients published in The Lancet in 86, and it was a bomb effect in the medical community. You know, everyone wanted to do balloon aortic valvuloplasty, tens of thousands of cases done, a number of index articles on the balloon aortic valvuloplasty and the registries, and the FDA approved in selected cases, so I was very proud of that. There was an improvement of symptoms, but one major unacceptable limitation that you know very well, you know, the earlier stenosis with a reoccurrence of aortic stenosis in 80% of the cases within 1 year or so. And so what to do next? So this was my big question. So in the 90s, you know, I was smelling, you know, the problem of restenosis after ballooning the valve. And so I said that something else had to be done. So implanting a valve prosthesis within the diseased calcific valve on the beating heart using regular percutaneous catheter-based techniques and local anesthesia. This was a challenging idea. And when I was talking around of this concept, you know, the comment of cardiac surgeons was always the same, you know, it's impossible, no chance of crossing a valve, no chance of opening a stent inside the calcific deposits of the valve leaflets, and very dangerous because of surrounding structure that you know very well. So I was very discouraged. But actually, I could observe during balloon aortic valvuloplasty that almost always, if not always, we could observe a circular balloon expansion in all the cases, you know. So came the idea that if we could make a stent strong enough to resist the compression of the aortic valve, it could be possible to implant a valve stent if we were able to implant a valvular structure inside the stent. So we did a landmark autopsy study that I will remind you here, you know, on 16 fresh specimens of calcific aortic stenosis. I did that with Elena Chaninoff. And I could observe that in all the cases, you know, a Palmas stent, it was used for peripheral vessels at that time, 23 millimeter in diameter, was able to open fully the valve, whatever the amount of calcium. And this was absolutely confirmed many years later by Renu Virmani in Washington, D.C., that it showed that even in case of massive calcification, like you can see here, the stent was able to open fully. And we were able also to demonstrate in Rouen that in spite of the what the surgeon said, if the length of the stent was below 17 millimeter, it was possible to implant the stent without occluding the coronary arteries and destroying the mitral valve and compressing the upper part of the interventricular septum with the His bundle. So this was very, very positive. And I did figure the stented valve and the procedure of TAVI at that time for a European patent application. So you see the model of valve that I had in mind. And I didn't know whether the valve would be in biology, in a polymer or in a pericardium, but we needed a high radial force balloon expandable stent. And with our surgeon, Professor Bessou, we made a handmade model of valve that you can see here, corresponding to my drawings very closely with a Palmas stent. And also we confirmed that the cream diameter of this valve was only 8 millimeter. So the concept of introducing the valve through the femoral artery retrograde to the heart was possible in a great number of patients. So the transfemoral approach was conceivable, and these are the drawings that I did for this European patent application. So we just had to make it. So during 9 years, you know, I have been looking for industrial support, and the comment from all experts, from all biomedical companies, including Edwards Life Sciences and Medtronic, was terrible. You know, it was totally unrealistic, major technical issue to make the valve, impossible to stent calcific aortic valve, a lot of complications associated with this if it could happen, you know, stroke, myocardial infarction, and so on. You can read all the complications that you can imagine. The stented valve would never be approved by the FDA, which was a strong argument in the United States. Surgery covered 100% of the need, which was not the case. There was no indications. And as a whole, it was the most stupid project ever heard, and the companies had to forget it. So it was really discouraging, and it might have been the end of the story, and several times I was thinking about abandoning this this idea. But we could create a startup, percutaneous valve technology, together with two engineers from Johnson & Johnson that you can see here, and Martin Leon, who was the medical director of Johnson & Johnson at that time. And all these three guys, you know, they believed that it was possible to make it and that there was a future of it for it. And so we created this startup, and we could have an agreement with a small company based in Israel, in Caesarea, near Tel Aviv, who invested and developed the device. You can see here the small company, very small company, and with new engineers that they have co-opted, you know, Asaf Bash, who really had been working very hard to make possible this dream. And the requests to engineers were very, very high, you know, making a prosthesis, highly resistant frame, with a valve inside, able to be homogeneously compressed over a high-pressure balloon for its introduction inside a sheath with a diameter of 7 to 9 millimeters at the most, enlarged by balloon inflation without any damage to the frame and the valvular structure. So I can tell you the challenge was extremely high, and they made it. And you can see here the valve that they made. So it was called percutaneous valve technology hard valve, which did correspond to my wishes, you know, a truly flat valve. It was done, made of polymer, and then they moved to horse pericardium with a stainless steel stent. There was a single diameter of 23 millimeter because this was the indication that I gave to company, and it was compatible with a 24 crin size. So with that, you know, they made a lot of laboratory testing in Israel, you know, and especially concerning the durability of the valve. You can see here the 5 years of the valve. They made a lot of studies on the stent frame. I don't enter into details. And on our side in Paris, with Elena Chaninoff, you know, in a very good facilities based in at the Institut Montsouris in Paris, we were using a valve crimped over a pneumatic balloon, and we were introducing the valve through the brachiocephalic trunk of the sheep model. And we could even, you know, for the first time, implant a valve on the orthotopic position. This was the only case where we succeeded, because all the other cases were a failure. But we implanted it at various parts, you know, in the aorta, the pulmonary artery. And also, we were able to prove that 5 months later, after implantation in the aorta, after creation of controlled aortic insufficiency to maintain the gradient distal in the aorta, the valve was absolutely unchanged at 5 months, and this was a very important request for future FDA approval. So the dreams come true, you know, in April 16, 2002. You probably have seen that several times, but it was an unbelievably young patient of 57 years old. He was absolutely dying at several episodes of cardiac arrest, came to the north of France in cardiogenic shock with a very low ejection fraction. He had a severe aortic stenosis on the bicuspid valve type 1. He had multiple comorbidities, and also he came with subacute leg ischemia with an occluded aorto bifemoral bypass. And cherry on the cake, he had a floating thrombus in the left ventricle. He had no femoral access. So the first thing that I did for him was an attempt of dilating the valve using the transseptal approach. We are mastering very well this technique, but it didn't work. And 24 hours later, he was back in shock. And so TAVI came as a last resort option, doing the transseptal approach. You know, it was really challenging and a miracle if it could work. So we just had to follow these arrows, you know, to reach the aortic valve. So you can see here the guide wire introduced in femoral vein and exiting to the femoral artery on the other side. And the valve was positioned in the middle of the calcium. And you see here that it was a very intense atmosphere in the cath lab at that time. And finally, you know, the valve could be delivered, taking the opportunity of a cardiac standstill, because it was almost in cardiac arrest. And the valve was delivered. It was well in place. And immediately, we had this unbelievable hemodynamic results with no gradient, an increase of the aortic pressure, and the vasopressors could be interrupted at that time. and you see the patients immediately after and the patients 8 days later. And this case reported in circulation, you know, was a second bomb blast in the medical community with the fury of the cardiac surgeons who could observe that I was coming back again after balloon valvuloplasty. So they were absolutely furious. And then I spent some time from the beginning because it's the most interesting for you. You know, we had a series of compassionate cases in 38 patients. And the health authority in France said that I had to do only all inoperable patients, class 4 imminent death, life expectancy of 2 weeks, and I had to use the transept approach. But actually, we did 7 cases with a retrograde approach, and we have a 75% success of implantation with a high rate of MACEs. Don't forget that we had a single size valve of 23 millimeter, but we have 50% survival of these patients, 1 to 6.5 years after return to normal life. So again, I show you these two cases because I think it's very important for you to understand why I got the conviction that there was a revolution on the way. You know, these patients who came very dying from Paris, 6 months later, totally resuscitated, and she was able to fly to Washington, D.C. to attend the TCT meeting. You know, this patient was dead when I did that, and she survived 6.5 years, a little more than that, and you can see her here. And the valve function was absolutely unchanged with the same gradient, same valve area. And this one also is very important because it's the first ever planned transfemoral retrograde approach without any delivery system. You see, for the first time, we could observe the valve coming from femoral artery. And this is the result that we obtained. So the first case of retrograde approach. And this lady, again, survived more than 5 years in excellent health and without any deterioration of the valve function. So I thought that better results could be anticipated in less severely diseased patients, and I start to believe that we could have in mind an expansion of indications. So these are the very first steps of TAVR offshore using the transseptal approach. You know, in 2005, the 100 patients mark was passed, and it was extremely emotional to share this experience with these friends. So then in 2004, there was a very important milestone. You know, this was a Cribier-Edwards valve that they acquired, Edwards, and they modified it a little, and they created a 26 millimeter size, which was so important, you know, to avoid PVL. And they used treated bovine pericardium. Actually, it was a Carpentier-Edwards bioprosthesis inside the stent. And it was conceived for implantation via the retrograde transfemoral approach, which was the key, you know, for spreading the technique over the world. So the transfemoral approach was using a delivery system that we call the Retroflex, which is a steerable system, a beautiful system, and this has been investigated by John Webb in Canada and then by a few number of centers, including ours in France. And very, very rapidly, you know, 2 years later, they came with a Retroflex 3, which was an improvement of the first one. And with this device, you know, we have done these very important studies that you know very well. So also, there was another revolution, the transapical approach. The surgeons started being involved with TAVR and believe in it. So this is the first case done in Leipzig with Michael Mack and Fred Inkmore, and I am like the devil entering into the OR for them. And there was a special delivery system again, but with the transfemoral and transapical, almost all TAVR candidates could be treated. Then in 2005 was launched the Concurrent device, the self-expanding core valve, later acquired by Medtronic. And this device has been wonderfully supported by Ebrard Gruber and my friend also Jean-Claude Laborde. It was coming from Jacques Seguin, a surgeon in France. And then at that time started a fair ongoing competition between the two TAVR concepts that is still ongoing. And when the valve came, you know, there was a very small size in present 2 hours, which was a very convincing feature for many operators. But there is absolutely no doubt, of course, that this device, in addition to the expandable system, played a fantastic role in the worldwide expansion of TAVR. So no one could have predicted the prodigious expansion of TIVR over 20 years, and the reason of success were double: continuous and rapid technological improvement and rigorous scientific evaluation, following a challenging and very unusual pathway in medicine from higher risk patients to all comers. So I just give you a few things concerning this technological improvement. First of all, a better patient screening, which was absolutely crucial with the help of the MSCT and the partnership that we could establish with the industry. Imaging technology was so important. The alternative approaches, new TAVI system and the Medtronic core valve in first place, improved valve and delivery system with lower profile, multiple size, improved frame geometry, prevention of PVL, a new indication, and the retrograde TF approach become the leader. It could be used in 95% of the cases, and using the minimalist approach, the minimalist strategy that we have been pioneering in Rouen since 1992. So just a constant and rapid, just to show you how fast it was, the historical valve, you know, between 2005 and 2012, you know, we moved from the Edwards Sapien to the Sapien 3, which was an extraordinary device, and the Medtronic core valve made the same kind of progress as, you know, going from the core valve to the Evolute. And it's not finished, it's ongoing on the recent years in the Sapien 3 Ultra, Sapien 3 Ultra Resilia for improving the life expectancy of the valve, the Evolute Heart to Evolute Pro Plus, so it never stops. And we had also some newer TAVI systems. So there was a system coming from Boston and Abbott, Symetis Portico. They were not extremely good, but they enormously improved with the Accurate Neo2 Navitor, you know, with changing frame geometry and adding a skirt outside, you know, to limit the PVL. And there is also this new balloon expandable valve, the Meryl, that I am very strongly supporting because I think they had many advantages and half sizes from 20 to 32 millimeters, so making the possibility of accurately selecting the valve size to the annulus. And the next generation of my valve is underway, you know, the octa-core, which is even better with an octagonal frame. And that time, you know, this frame doesn't shorten when you inflate the valve, so it will make the whole thing much easier. Rigorous scientific evaluation, I don't spend time because you know the story, you know, thousands and thousands of patients enrolled in a registry, control registry, match registry versus surgery in intermediate cases and randomized trial in patients at decreasing risk with Edwards and Medtronic TAVI system. So we reach a new paradigm. You know, 20 years ago, TAVR was conceived for inoperable or very high-risk patients, and now surgery is reserved for patients who are not optimal candidates for TAVR. So the apotheosis came in 2019 with FDA approval in low-risk patients, followed by the European recommendation with the Sapien 3 and Medtronic, and today we have 2 million valves implanted about, you know, in more than 80 countries in the world, and the TAVI market exceeds the surgical market in many countries, including USA, and the expected growth for many reasons that will be explained later is more than 10% per year. And the future of TAVR looks even brighter. So it was a long, bulky road. You can see here my last slide, you know, starting with balloon aortic valvuloplasty in 85. You can see here the first in man, the CE mark commercialization, partner one, partner two, partner three, expansion to all comers. 35 years since BAV and 20 years since the first in man case, and extension of TAVR indications on the way, you know, with especially asymptomatic patients, moderate AS, and other indications. So, besides paving the way for many interventional techniques for treating other valvular and structural heart disease, I think that TAVR has changed the entire medical culture by bringing the teamwork concept, which is so important in our work. Thank you very much for your attention.
I'm going to give the next lecture. When I was given this assignment, which is to talk about recent guidelines, how it would change the practical indication of TAVR in the coming years. Obviously, I was dreaded to read, you know, over 200 pages of guidelines, which obviously none of you probably want to do that. So, as you know, these valvular heart disease guidelines has been going on for the last decade, and the most recent one sort of both from ESC and AECC, AHA, in the last couple years. But what is really the consensus and what are the differences? Just for sort of the everyday practice, how does it actually affect us when we are selecting patients for TAVR versus SAVRs? So fortunately, there's an article that was recently published that really summarizes some of these differences between the two sets of guidelines. And I tried to pull some of the highlights in here and my own interpretation. So this is really the summary of the two sort of guidelines and what are the differences and what are the similarity. I think on the top here, the shared class of recommendations, really, I think these are the things that we operate on, the heart team approach, as well as the timing for AVR. And I think most of the time, the difference are really maybe one class of recommendation difference. And some of them obviously are unique to each guidelines. For example, on this side here for ACC and AHA, some you know, mentioning, for example, the surgical risk scores, while the ESC no longer really mention the risk score at all. The key area of differences, and I will mention that a little bit more detail later on, is the asymptomatic aortic stenosis patient. What is the threshold of EF below which you would actually fix the valve? And also the TAVR versus SAVR, what is the age threshold? There's a difference between the two sets of guidelines. So if you start looking at the heart team management and risk scores between the two, and I'm not going to obviously read through these, if you just sort of look at it on the top, is that the exact definition of a heart team is still relatively open, meaning in some institution is really one surgeon and one cardiologist, and in many places could be a whole team that sometimes up to, you know, with imagers, with echocardiographers, could be up to 20 people meeting each time. Again, do all patients need a heart team, especially out of the US? Do you actually have, you know, just looking at the high-risk patients and, you know, discuss with the surgeons and interventional cardiologists or asymptomatic patients? But obviously in the US is mandatory because of the reimbursement by the government. Medicare and Medicaid has pushed for these heart teams in order to get reimbursement. I think the risk scores no longer is a decision point. I think from both sets of guidelines, it's really a reference, so you have an idea of what risk these patients approximately are. But TAVR versus SAVR is really based on life expectancy, which is really part of the lifetime management and also the prosthesis durability. I think it floats into all of our calculations is the frailty of the patients, because clearly if the patient is quite frail, surgery is a big sort of mountain for them to climb. If you look at these symptoms, no symptom standpoint, there's a lot of high points that is mentioned in both of these guidelines. Again, I'll try to summarize that in this table here. So if you look at asymptomatic aortic stenosis, the ones that we typically treat are high gradient AS, and I think both sets of guidelines that you need to replace the valve. In low flow, low gradient aortic stenosis with reduced EF, typically set at 50%. We, in a live case earlier, we typically do, you know, dobutamine stress echocardiography to really check the contractile reserve. And then from that, whether you have true AS or pseudo AS, you know, you would either have AVR or you have medical therapy. And if you have no contractile reserve, and that sometimes can be difficult to really figure out, suggestion is whether you use the CT calcium score to figure out when actually the valve is actually quite severely stenotic. But here, there's some differences between the two guidelines. It's really left to the individual patient as well as the individual team. So that's the sort of the ambiguity in this part. If patients have low flow, low gradient with preserved ejection fraction, this is sort of called a paradoxical aortic stenosis. And I think those sets of two guidelines, again, because very little is known about this subset, so two guidelines are a little bit sort of deviated here. You may still do AVR if you think that the aortic stenosis is severe, and if the ACC guidelines is that you would do AVR if the AS is felt to be this, the cause of the symptoms. So that's this group of patients with a paradoxical AS is still needs to be defined further. If you have asymptomatic aortic stenosis, I think this is a piece that we still obviously a lot of work needs to be done. But if you have a severe AS with reduced EF less than 50%, both guidelines think that you should have AVR. If you have preserved ejection fraction, and I think if your EF in the ESC guidelines less than 55%, and you don't have any other cause, you should have your AVR. In ACC AHA, the threshold is set at less than 60%. So again, there's some slight differences, but as, again, to try to put your sort of eggs in the ejection fraction, sometimes difficult, as you know, it fluctuates over time. So for us, typically, is serial echocardiography is helpful, maybe 3 months apart, maybe 6 months apart, to see whether there's any change. And again, this is the, if you have a lot of adverse prognostic features, and we can go through that a little bit, really severe AS, for example, or elevated BNP, or there is sort of a longitudinal strain pattern on your echocardiography, people may think that you should have your valve change as well. But obviously, when you have normal flow, low gradient AS with preserved EF, typically these are classified as moderate aortic stenosis, and you would have regular follow-up dictated by both guidelines. So again, so the preserved EF is what is the definition. There's some slight changes, maybe 5% or so, but I think that's really semantic, and I would take it not really literally in terms of the percentage. And very severe AS typically is greater than 5 meters per second in Vmax, and mean gradient is greater than 60. The subtle definition of prognostic features, I think, you know, we have, you know, subject to some interpretation, but most of the time is really elevated BNP and hypertrophy and strain. I think low flow, low gradient with preserved EF is still a little bit controversial how exactly to approach individual patient. I think, you know, in this guidelines, there's actually not much mention about bicuspid aortic valve, which is kind of interesting because that's obviously a debate between TAVR versus SAVR most of the time in our valve meeting. But if you look at it, really, you know, sort of TAVR versus SAVR in terms of the discussion, I think guideline in terms of the age criteria is not really robust, meaning that if you look at less than 65 years old, it's really surgical AVR for both of the guidelines, 65 to 75. SAVR versus TAVR is you know, recommended by sort of the European guidelines, while SAVR equals to TAVI is according to the American guidelines. And I think above 75, both are pretty much lined up as well. And I think you look at other criteria, surgical risk, as well as comorbidities, anatomy, and frailty are generally the five factors that you look through in terms of TAVR versus SAVR. And if you look at some of the additional consideration, which obviously as we have more data from various trials will help us really understand the stages of aortic stenosis, how that integrates into the heart team integration, as well as what are the other approaches. For example, if it's non-transfemoral, do you prefer actually SAVR in that situation, in some of these situations? And obviously Ross procedure we talked about earlier has come back into vogue. Again, I think this is sort of the summary slides that we now look, hopefully going forward, as a little bit more looking at the valve as one of the two dimension. One valve, and how tight the valve is in terms of the vertical sort of rows here is really that. But the other part is how the ventricle react to the valve getting narrowed over time. And I think by sort of plotting this sort of diagram, you start to understand that aortic valve replacement is really on, obviously, patients have a lot of, you know, quite severe aortic stenosis and also some of the ventricular sort of morphology that becomes adverse. But obviously, we still need to learn a little bit more about the moderate aortic stenosis, for example, in the PROGRESS trial, as well as the patient that are asymptomatic in the early TAVR trial. And then finally, we talked about a little earlier is how to treat patients that are in the early stages of aortic stenosis and how to prevent them from progressing or preventing aortic stenosis is really the next challenge. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. I think we can move now to the next presentation. From Dr. Palmierini, new innovation in transcatheter valve intervention, new techniques and new valve. Thank you, Dr. Palmierini.
Thank you. Thank you. So innovation with next generation THV will pertain leaflet technology and guaranteeing longer valve durability and therefore allowing extension of indication to a younger population, valve performance with better deliverability, reduced rates of pacemaker implantation and paravalvular leak, and commissural alignment for better coronary access, treatment of pure aortic regurgitation, and plan for THV in THV. This is the next iteration of the Evolut platform. It's the Evolut FX system, which has a redesigned tip an increased capsule flexibility, and a single spine shaft, and all these iteration will improve the deliverability of the device. There is an optimized stability layer for more predictable deployment. And finally, three radiopaque markers, which will assist with optimal valve deployment in terms of depth of implantation and commissural alignment. So this is a simulation of the implantation, the FX. You see that unsheathing the valve is supposed to be very, very stable, whereas with the old device, when you unsheath the valve, you have a kind of dipping into the ventricle, such as that you have continually to adjust the position pushing over the wire. And finally, the presence of the three radiopaque marker and the use of the cusp overlap technique will make commissural alignment more easy. Sapien X4 is the iteration of the Sapien platform. It has a low frame 8 and large cell to facilitate coronary access, resilient tissue technology, and enhanced outer skirt to further reduce the risk of paravalvular leak. This is the Resilia technology. So with the current technique, the use of glutaraldehyde for fixation and storage produce free aldehyde. And free aldehydes in vivo can bind calcium, and this is a mechanism that is believed to produce structural valve degeneration. With the integrity preservation technology, the use of a small amine produces a stable capping of this aldehyde, and in addition, glycerol displaces water from the tissue, which enables dry storage. Resilia tissue valve is available also for the S3 Ultra platform. X4 will come into three valve size with 16 unique deployment diameter, which depends on the volume you load to inflate the valve. In addition, the crimping of the valve will happen directly on the balloon, and the delivery system has a valve rotation control to enable commissural alignment. So IENA valve was devised to treat pure aortic valve regurgitation. It is a supra-annular self-expanding valve with large open cell design, which enables easy coronary access. But the distinctive aspect of this valve is the presence of three locators that serve to align the valve with the cusp. These slides summarize the three steps to implant this valve. First, alignment, which the locators are aligned in correspondence of the leaflet. Then positioning and anchoring, with locators clipping onto native valves. And finally, deployment. And this is a real case. First, you have alignment with the locators and the cusp. And then you have deployment of the valve with the perfect final result. So this valve has a very interesting concept because it may combine the advantages of balloon expandable valve and self-expanding valve. It's the Anteris DuraVar valve, which is indeed the balloon expandable valve with short frame 8 and large open cell geometry to facilitate the coronary access. It has a delivery system that can rotate to achieve commissural alignment, and the leaflets are treated with an anti-calcification tissue process, which is DNAi and glutaraldehyde free. It has also a PET skirt, which is supposed to minimize the risk of paravalvular leak. The interesting concept of this valve is that it is made of single piece of bovine pericardium tissue, so the tissue, this single piece of tissue is folded to design the valve. And this design should guarantee near normal hemodynamic function, better leaflet collaptation, and less leaflet stress. In addition, this design provides more a larger effective orifice area as compared to three-piece valves. The valve has already been tested in humans, 13 cases with an optimal hemodynamic results and also restoration of normal aortic flow that by a magnetic resonance was similar to a healthy aortic valve. Finally, polymeric valves, which are produced by automatic robotic manufacturing, which allows high reproducibility and lower cost. The polymeric compounds may be modified to meet the needs of THV in terms of biostability, biocompatibility, leaflet strength, and durability. So we don't have such kind of valves tested in human for TAVI, but we do have one surgical valve, which is the Foldax Trier heart valve, which has been tested in 10 patients. Therefore, it's a surgical valve. And in bench testing, it is supposed to have a long durability up to 16 years and a low ex vivo thrombogenicity. So in conclusion, iteration of aortic THV is progressing relentlessly with new devices coming with longer valve durability and better performance in terms of deliverability, pacemaker implantation, paravalvular leak, and better commissural alignment for coronary access. Polymeric health valves have the potential of long durability, biostability, biocompatibility, and leaflet strength, and therefore should be tested in clinical trials to prove their safety and efficacy. Thank you.
Thank you. The next lecture is to be delivered by Samir Kapadia. He's talking about PROTECT TAVR, a statistical or clinical interpretation, and my take-home messages, Samir.
Thank you very much for the invitation. So I have one disclosure that I was the PI of the trial, but no financial interest. So I put it in four different questions. So brief overview of the protected trial data that were not presented in the main manuscript, data in context with other data, and then my personal recommendation. So the brief overview, so this was a multi-center trial which was published in New England Journal. It is a trial, prospective, post-market, very important to recognize that it started in 51 centers in North America, Europe, and Australia, and it started during COVID and ended during COVID. So this was a very important thing that we started all the sites in the pandemic and finished the trial. So this was interesting. The other part is that there are 3,000 patients randomized. So just remember that all the TAVR trials that we just talked about, 1,500 patients or at the most 2,000 patients randomized. So this is a trial which is studying an ancillary device, and now we are using 3,000 patients to randomize the trial. So in itself, it is a difficult thing to do that we are having a device that is not as expensive and we are doing a trial that is very difficult to do in a large trial to do. 1,500 patients in each arm, TAVR only or TAVR with CEP, and our primary endpoint was stroke at 72 hours or discharge. So if you discharge before 72 hours, then we would consider that as a primary endpoint. And all the patients were seen by neurologists, and the adaptive trial design was that at 70% enrollments, that is 2,100 patients, we would analyze the data and then we either increase or continue with the same design. So we continued with the same number. As you can see, the patients were fairly well distributed, except in the CEP arm, there were slightly more women. Otherwise, the extreme low risk and intermediate risk patients were enrolled in the trial, and the calcification severity was judged by the operators similar, and CHEDVAS score was relatively high. Control and CEP both had balloon expandable and self-expanding valves. 63% balloon expandable and non-balloon expandable were 36%. Almost all patients had tricuspid valve, 8% bicuspid valve. Pre-dilation was done in 41%, post-dilation in 25%. So the primary endpoint was stroke at 72 hours, and as you can see, 2.9% versus 2.3% in the control versus CEP arm. Difference was statistically not significant. If you look at the disabling stroke, however, it was 1.3 versus 0.5%, and p-value was 0.02. Of course, this was a secondary endpoint, not the primary endpoint, and this is the part of statistical analysis that if the primary endpoint is negative, it is a hypothesis-generating idea rather than any proof. But still, 1.3 versus 0.5%. Now, if you look a little bit in detail, the mechanism of stroke, so there were 17 strokes that were seen ischemic strokes in the control group versus 6 in the CEP group. So 17 versus 6 disabling strokes. So this is again a fairly significant difference. And if you look at the, if you look at these strokes, this is also very important mechanistically to understand. So all the green part of the stroke, so you can see that the CEP was not deployed or CEP was deployed, patient had CPR, there was an embolized valve, or these strokes happened in the unprotected territories, meaning in the occipital lobe, which is not covered by the sentinel device. Whereas two patients had hemorrhagic strokes, only one patient had a middle cerebral artery stroke, which was covered. So again, this tells you that at least mechanistically, the device was working in all the patients. When we did the subgroup analysis, and then we will, you know, all the subgroups were statistically not significantly different except in the US population. So the US population, if you look at the US population, the study was positive for all strokes, and in disabling stroke, the US population was positive. So this is something important to keep in mind, that this was a subgroup that was positive. So what was not covered? So this regional difference is a very important part to keep in mind. So if you look at the outside of US, there were about 1,167 patients. US was 1,833 patients. And if you look at the stroke primary endpoint, outside of US, there was more strokes, 3.5% compared to 2% in United States. However, if you look at the disabling strokes, they're very similar in all the population. That was about 1%. If you look at the outside of US cohort, all strokes were no different and disabling strokes were no different. So all the 1,100 patients that were studied outside, there was no difference. If you look at the US population, that is 1,800 patients in the US population, both endpoints were statistically significantly reduced. So all stroke, which was a primary endpoint, and disabling stroke, which was secondary endpoint, both were positive in the US population that we studied. I didn't put all in the particular subject that what were the differences between the two populations, but the most important difference was the self-expanding valve versus balloon expandable valve. In US, there are more balloon expandable valves. In the Europe, there are more self-expanding valves. Clinical outcomes in the patients with the stroke, this is also very important. So in the sentinel patient, when they developed stroke, the mortality was 2.9%. In the control group, when they developed stroke, the mortality was 4.7%. Where they were discharged, the sentinel group were discharged home, whereas the control group were not, 70 versus 41%. And higher intensity care was needed in the control group as defined a priori. And discharge and length of stay was also kind of similar. So data in context of other data, that what are the other things that we know? So if you look at the real world data, 2,300 patients in United States, Dr. Cohen published this, 30-day death rate in the CEP group was 1.4% and no CEP group was 2.2% reduced. And if you look at the nationwide readmission database, if you look at the in-hospital death in the patient with a stroke with a CEP was less compared to patients who had no CEP. Cleveland Clinic, same experience with us, 3,000 patients. And if you look at the data that we analyzed, again, the intensity of stroke was less, the modified Rankin score was different, and the death rate of the people with the stroke of 15 strokes, 4 people died without CEP, and 8 people with CEP who had stroke, nobody died. So in summary, the mortality of the stroke is reduced in patients with CEP compared to those without CEP. What is the personal recommendation? So first of all, it's a short procedure. You know, you're going to go through the radial artery, deploy the device. Here we are putting the device in, and I don't want to show this, but anyway, it is 1.34 minutes that it takes to deploy the device without any splicing or cutting of the film. So it's a simple device. And these are our data, so I just pulled our data to say that in last 4 years, we have done 3,100 TAVR cases, 0.4% mortality, 0.5% stroke rate, no death with stroke. AR more than 2%, more than 2 is 0.4%. New pacemaker is 2.9%. So if you are going to use the CEP device in everybody and do the TAVR with this kind of efficacy, it is very hard to argue that we do not use the CEP device, because people, the expectation is super high to prevent the stroke. Stroke is less in TAVR compared to surgery. So this is a very important thing to keep in mind, especially for the next debates. But even then, it is higher than PCI. Now, when people come to the cath lab, they expect stroke to be equal to PCI. They're not equaling to the surgery. So this is higher. So stroke is a clinical problem still. Central device has been associated with lower risk of disabling or major strokes, as I showed you in different data sets. Device is safe. There is no safety concern. And stroke remains unpredictable. So it's very difficult to predict who will have the stroke. And the use of Sentinel, therefore, at least in our setting, I personally recommend it, and especially if you can afford it, this is the only part that is important to keep in context. Thank you.
Maybe we can just have a few any questions, otherwise we can go on the lectures and then come back to discussion, maybe, because we're running slightly late. So why don't we just go ahead and have the next lecture, which is now the, really the Games of Thrones. 2023. So I don't know what Eberhard is representing. And you have the right hair color for the dragon house, right?
Alan, can I just say something? So after all these talks, we still need debate. I think I'm worried that I was not that good then.
All right. So Eberhard, your take, your side is TAVR is better.
Thank you very much, Alan. Game of Thrones, it's a big name. And as we all know, TAVR versus surgery, it used to be fierce in the past. And basically, even though you were colleagues at the early days, as Alan pointed out to you, we were not friends. And here you see the two walking hand in hand. The question, though, is, Vinny, who is Daenerys Targaryen, the lady on the left side? Is it you or is it me? Be it as it is, they're going hand in hand. And I think it is important for you to realize we are still friends, and we will be still friends after this debate. So conventional aortic valve surgery is the most successful operation in the history of cardiac surgery. Is there a better way? Can we challenge the excellent, good results of conventional aortic valve surgery? Yes, we can. And this is really a summary, and that's the answer to the question that was initially posed on us, which is better. And this is the evolution of the clinical evidence in robust, randomized trials across the risk spectrum with the two leading valve technologies. The answer is there. The guidelines adapted and to the right side, as we heard before, no longer risk stratification, it is more an age separation and the discussion within the heart team. So also some key patient and physician endpoints which we should remember. What matters to the patients and to the physicians? Obviously, to both mortality, stroke, quality of life, and long-term outcome, for the most part, durability. And then more to the physicians, resource utilization, and challenging patient populations. So let me hammer some slides out without going into details. TAVR has a mortality advantage over surgery in all the risk spectrum, as you can see here. TAVR has a stroke advantage over surgery. Stroke rates are better than surgery, with contemporary devices and clinical trials making TAVR the preferred therapy. TAVR has a quality of life advantage over surgery, less adverse events, less acute kidney injury, atrial fibrillation, and bleeding. TAVR has a quality of life advantage over surgery, faster recovery. So TAVR is 6-minute walk test, faster return to active lives, and then the KCCQ questionnaire advantage. TAVR has less rehospitalizations than surgery, both in the Evolute low-risk trial and the PARTNER 3 trial, has improved resource utilization with less procedure time, less ICU stay, and less hospital stay. More cost-effective over time in PARTNER 2A, 2 year, and SAPIEN 3 at 1 year. And of course, very important for the question of durability, hemodynamic advantages over surgery. Then bioprosthetic durability controversy, something that's very important in these days. Obviously, this is an ongoing discussion, but THVs have collected more rigorous durability data than any surgical valve so far. So let us continue with TAVR versus surgery, new information over the past 12 to 24 months, longer-term outcomes from randomized clinical trials. And here we come to the notion 8-year all comers, and as Jeff pointed out, we are awaiting the 10-year results. It's an all comer trial, as you well know, in Scandinavia with patients more than 70 years old, comparing surgery with first generation core valve. And you can see very good results out to 8 years. TAVR versus surgery, all-cause mortality the same, structural valve deterioration important for life, for valve performance. TAVR is better, hemodynamics are better, and bioprosthetic valve failure as performance of the valve also slightly better. Then the PARTNER 2 intermediate risk 5 years, clinical and echocardiographic outcome, if you compare XT to surgery, there's no difference, and also no difference in the gradient. And on Edwards S3 to surgery, which is not randomized trial, they are the same. The CoreValve Evolute pooled analysis objective was to evaluate the incidence, outcomes, and predictors of hemodynamic structural valve deterioration, because that's the question that was imposed on us from the very beginning. You know, this is not durable and you're no good in the long term, but now we do have long-term data, and basically comparing CoreValve US pivotal and Sotavi trials with surgery. And if you look at the 5-year structural valve deterioration adjusted for competing risk of mortality, you can see in red surgery and in blue TAVR better. You can see 5-year SVD in larger and smaller annulus diameter, TAVR better, even more pronounced in the small annulus. So very important also what's been stressed this morning, SVD impacts mortality. And that's what we should remember when we talk about these numbers. Very important that we try to avoid structural valve deterioration. Moving on to 5-year valve performance, BVD, cumulative incidence, TAVR better than surgery. The same, patients with small and large annuli, also TAVR better than surgery. And again here, BVD impacts mortality in outcomes. So valve performance is not only numbers, it is important that we keep this in mind and that we continue looking at it as we move forward. So TAVR, in my opinion, is the preferred treatment option. On the left side, you see the past. Surgery was the primary goal, and then whoever was not a good candidate for surgery went to TAVR. On the right side, that's the opposite now. So my thing is life expectancy are the key metrics. TAVR will be treatment of choice for all isolated tri-leaflet aortic stenosis patients age more than 65 years. Reasonable treatment options, because we're awaiting trial results. Small annuli, asymptomatic moderate AS, aortic regurgitation, bicuspid aortic stenosis, and concomitant cardiovascular disease, such as multivessel disease, coronary heart disease, and atrial fibrillation. With that, my friend, good luck now.
So, Vinny, you're gonna be talking about SAVRs better, of course.
So I think, thank you. Just before I start, how many surgeons are in the room other than me? So this is unfair competition, but I always like to win unfair competition. This is just a case to show, don't start the timer. This is a Star Edwards in mitral, which was treated with Evolutar. The only reason this patient's alive after 50 years was he had surgery. So this is my point. These are my disclosures. This is me with Eberhard wearing green, but I'm so influenced by him that I've started wearing black shirts now. So you can see that he's very dear to me. We saw brilliant presentation of 20-year journey. We have already seen, you know, 6 lectures or 60 already to say TAVR's amazing. It's been approved since 2019 in all risk patients. So literally you can treat everyone. So is it the new gold standard? And I do both, and my answer is no. The reason is, these are some of the myths which, you know, we every day hear them, so we start believing in it very strongly. So the first myth is all TAVRs function same. So the trial was given approval based on these, but you can see here that the only 2 surgical valves which have failed are these 2, but many TAVR devices have failed rapidly. So all the design changes which happen are not for good. Second myth, again, is circularity doesn't matter. Actually, it does matter. You know, the same industry produces SAVR valves and TAVR valves as well. So in surgery, we implant a perfectly circular valve, leaflets are never touched, anticalcification treatment has been used for a very long time. But in TAVR, no valve is ever circular or cylindrical. And of course, you know, this is a Valentine's Day special. But we believe that this is going to be amazing. So I think, I don't know here in Korea, but I haven't seen anybody, you know, riding a bicycle with square wheels. But we say that, no, it will be fine. Second myth, or third myth, balloon doesn't affect. We do BAVs many times. This is just a valve in a MAC, and this is after implantation. And you see what happens to the leaflets. And this was a live case at TCT, so I'm not bluffing. You can see the imprints of the grid on the valve leaflets. This could be the reason why you see more non-statistically significant halt incidents. But we say, actually, seriously, it doesn't matter. It's okay. Fourth myth, PPM is only in SAVR. We have heard already from Eberhard. It's very confusing. Between Evolutar and Sapien, we are still fighting how to measure EOA. So I don't know how you don't know, if you don't know how to measure EOA, how you can start thinking of PPM. And in Partner 3, if I remember correctly, the EOAs were larger in SAVR rather than TAVR. So actually, PPM should be less in SAVR than TAVR. TAVR durability is amazing, and that's the fifth myth. And look at the number of publications, 12,000 publications in 10 years. It's outstanding. You know, a lot of them are self-reported, self-adjudicated, a lot of white paper, and a lot of expert opinions. So this is, again, to show you what happens when we alter some things. So on one hand, we are told TAVR is going to last for 25 years. But on the other hand, this is very interesting, midterm outcome of TAVR. What is midterm? 1 year. So the timeline for TAVR reporting is very different. In my mind, 3 months is early. 3 months to 3 years is midterm. And then anything beyond 3 is long term. So I think we have to start judging, you know, the literature properly. And the worst thing about TAVR is we have no strategy for lifetime management. We have walked into this, lower the age, lower the risk profile, but we have forgotten completely what we are going to do when these things come back. We have no idea. So as a surgery, at least I can do root enlargement, put a bigger valve, they can have a valve in valve. But for TAVR, it's a problem because we are implanting valves now higher and higher. If you look at Sapien XT to Sapien 3, the valve's taller and we are implanting it 90-10. So we are reaching ST junction every day. So if we do TAVR in TAVR in these patients, we are going to have really poor lifetime management, but we don't think of that. If you look at the TAV in TAV registry, this is early results, very bad results. Honestly, if the first valve didn't last for 3 years, how long is the second valve going to last? Maybe 1 year or maybe 2 if you're lucky. And in fact, recent publications will show that 30 to 60% of patients with various designs of TAVR may not even be suitable for TAV in TAV. But we still say, you know, TAVR is great. Lastly, TAVR explant. DivRx plant results are not perfect yet. We're improving, but again, the mortality is much higher. So again, I think these patients are going to suffer. Then the final level one publication is social media. And this is lifetime management. We show Mick Jagger dancing after 7 days. But we forget that despite open heart surgery, Bill Clinton is still alive after 20 years. So I think open heart surgery doesn't kill patients. Right treatment saves patients. Wrong treatment kills patients. So I think this is what I feel. Is it good really for patients with long-term life expectancy? Probably not. I think we need to wait. And I still feel that it is good for patients with short life expectancy. And I think this is the final slide. In Korea and Japan, the life expectancy is much longer. So in these patients, if you keep implanting TAVRs at 65, they are going to come back with multiple procedures, and there will be more damage done to them in their life expectancy. Lastly, but not least, you know, if this is a patient who is 65, I would do a mini AVR. A patient will probably stay in the hospital for 4 days more and will take 3 weeks to recover. But at least I have done, you know, good to this patient, because this patient has got a more durable treatment with a good lifetime management option. And if I do a TAVR in this patient is 100% going to need a second intervention or even maybe a third intervention, and the cumulative risk is going to be much higher. So patients who live longer, and when I say longer, I would say even more than 10 years. If you do a TAVR, patient's going to have multiple, you know, procedures with cumulative risk, which is going to be very high. Samir showed nicely that the risk is lower, but I don't know how you can have pacemaker rates of 2% unless 10% patients already had a pacemaker before. But majority of the practical data, TVT data, shows pacemaker rates are high as well. So I think this is not best for short-term recovery. SAVR is the best choice in these patients, because you can probably have only one procedure, maybe another procedure which is valve-in-valve. And I think, according to Dr. Grube, you know, imperfect is the new perfect, and TAVR is good. But I think if you think logically, no, it cannot be new perfect, because TAVR is a good compromise. And lastly, I hope I make you laugh, but we surgeons tend to meditate while we're listening to this for a very long time. And this is TAVR durability. You think it's 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. All right. Thank you.
That's a very good. So maybe we can ask, you know, the panels to really sort of maybe poke holes in each of the, you know, debaters.
Maybe can I come back on the something that I am very interested in the cerebral protection device. This is a big problem for us in France, you know, because the protection device is not reimbursed. It's quite expensive. So we have to manage to find another solution. And actually, the number of cases, you know, you gave percentage on 1,500 patients, but if you take the population of TAVR in Rouen, for example, in 1 year, we have more or less 150, 160 patients, or maybe 200 this year. And the number of patients with stroke is extremely low. You know, the number of patients suffering a stroke is—it's maybe one patient a year, and not every year. So, you know, it's a dilemma, because should we spend this amount of money making this other approach on the arm to the hypothesis of saving one stroke a year, you know? So this is for us a problem. And the solution that we have found is, since we cannot get this protection device without spending a lot of money, it's to manage to have the smoothest possible procedure. And I think that if you take the series of patients with stroke, probably we'll find some good reason for a patient to have stroke. You know, you said that it's unpredictable. But actually, in our experience, Those patients with stroke had some additional problems. For example, they had a lot of calcifications, or we did the pre-dilatation, or we post-dilated the valve several times. We had a very hard time to cross the valve. You know, these kind of things that make the procedure a little longer. And if the procedure is long or not very well done, the risk of stroke is probably very much higher. Also, the problem of the time that you spend to position the valve, you know, for example, it's longer with a core valve. Sometimes you have to remove it, you put a second valve and so on, and this has to be put in the basket, you know, when you think about stroke protection. So I think the best thing to do is to teach how to cross the aortic valve very simply, how to position the valve very quickly, how to avoid pre or post dilatation of the valve if possible. And if you do that, you will have a decrease of the stroke rate without cerebral protection device. Now, if it comes reimbursed, you know, the problem will be totally different.
David?
Yeah, I mean, again, I often am the one in these days arguing that we, you know, don't have enough evidence to support embolic protection for all patients yet. I do think if the second trial, if the protected TAVI or the protect TAVI trial shows benefit, especially if it shows it for the disabling stroke, I think it will be very hard to argue that we shouldn't use it there. I think the data in the United States, even without neurologic adjudication, is that 2% of our patients undergoing TAVR have stroke. It's not, you know, it's not one out of 150 or out of 200. It's 2%. So it's a real disease. We just have to prove that it works. And so I think that, you know, to me, that's the goal. I mean, it may well be that you're right, that if you can do it really slick every time, it's a little less than that. But, you know, we have to be able to tell that ahead of time. The things that you just described, like the procedure takes long to cross the valve or you have to reposition it, those are not predictable. They're identifiable afterwards. So I think that's the challenge. We still can't really predict. But right now, I think the data still isn't there. And I assume that if the data does become very convincing, that governments like the French government and the U.S. government will reimburse it.
Yeah, no, I just want to highlight that I agree with Dr. Kribi. Of course, that if you are very slick, you maybe it's less. But at the same time, remember, we are treating both spectrum of diseases. So we are treating more calcified valves now, bicuspid valves, and we are treating very low-risk patients who have very high expectations, right? They are jogging, they are coming to you, they are having a little bit shortness of breath. So these people, if you develop a stroke, and we are talking about the money as a breakpoint, we are not talking about safety as a breakpoint. So when the money is an equation in question, then these people who are younger, who are coming for a procedure, the expectations are so different. So yeah. It is very, very hard that if you did not put a cerebral protection device and if the guy developed a stroke and cannot just move his left hand, this will be a terrible thing for the patient. So this is the reason why it is difficult to make that decision, although I agree with you that the trial, we need more data, and we are working very diligently to get some more data.
So Samir, while you're here, so you talk about out of US, obviously, no difference, right? You talk about the percentage of using the self-expanding is higher in out of US. Any other factors? Why is it different in out of US?
Okay, and I know we try to look at the ACT levels. We try to look at the procedural time. We try to look at the pre-dilation, post-dilation. All of them have some differences. How do you put in a retrospective analysis these things together to say that what is the difference is difficult. My personal bias is that the centers that used in the United States were more experienced in general because it has been available in the United States and we use 25 cases as a cut point, and that may be the reason. But again, there is no way to highlight from the statistical standpoint exactly why this happened. But 1,800 patients in the United States is not a small number of patients to completely ignore the data.
I'm sorry, can I make just a short comment again? You know, when we are talking of the stroke rate in hospital, you know, you say the less than 72 hours. you know, the cerebral protection device protect during the procedure, not one day later. So, I mean, you are protecting the patients who will have an embolic stroke accident during the procedure, but you cannot protect the patients afterwards, you know, even after a few hours when they are back in their bed, you know, so the protection stopped there. So I think we have to make sure of what we are talking about, you know, if we have to protect the patients during the procedure or if you want to protect the patients after the procedure, you know, so it makes also a difference in the numbers.
I agree. And again, one last comment for that part is that most of the emboli happen during the procedure, although the clinical manifestations may happen later. So it is possible that you embolize at the time of procedure, but 8 hours later, when the ACT wears off or when the blood pressure drops or whatever the other reasons are, that you have a neurological event. We have seen that because we did when the Sentinel trial, we did the MRIs before and CT scans. We saw calcium, but no symptoms. And the same patient, after 48 hours, no further calcium, but have symptoms. So this does happen in this patient population. So even though events do not happen right away, the culprit may have happened at the time of procedure. So this is something to keep in mind when we analyze the data.
So in a trial, how many of these disabling stroke were actually rescued, meaning that they have no retrieval, have different type of, neuro IR procedures?
So very few, very few. So it looks like that, at least reading the charts, because we didn't systematically collect their information, but very few patients, probably out of 16 patients with disabling strokes, probably three patients, but had a neurological intervention.
May I ask a question?
Yes, please.
A question to Samir, actually. Did you say that a stroke in an elderly patient is less important than in a younger? And if so, I would like to have the opinion of the moderators. And
I didn't mean to say that. What I meant to say is that the expectations are changing. People are coming to the cath lab with the expectation of angioplasty. When they're coming for aortic wall replacement, they're not coming for aortic wall replacement. They feel that they are going to get a stent because they're awake, they are going to go home the same day. So they are not thinking that a 1% stroke rate is acceptable. They are thinking 1 in 1,000 stroke rate is acceptable. So this is the difference that we are facing.
Yeah, I think, I mean, the point that you raise, Horst, is, you know, a good one about, you know, elderly patients versus younger patients. I think, you know, what we can agree on, I hope, is that if a patient dies from a stroke, which, you know, happens in 20% of them, that an 85-year-old patient will have 5 years taken off their life expectancy, and a 65-year-old patient will have 20 years taken off their life expectancy. That's the fact. Whether you want to judge it that way is a political decision and a ethical decision. But the fact is that the life expectancy differences are there.
Yes, please, go ahead.
Dr. Kahadiat, did you analyze the debris in the
filter? Yes. No, we did not, again, for the cost part of it, because we thought of it, but this is impossible to do, 3,000 patients. No, we did it in the first trial. So we did it in the first trial, 343 patients, 99% of the filters. Alok is not here, but Dr. Varmani and Alok, we did. And we did a low-risk trial where we did, again, same trial he did, where we collected the debris from low-risk patient. All the filters had identical to the original, 99% of filters. So that's why FDA approved it. FDA approved it because we found something in the filter.
So maybe we can ask the panel, if you're going to need a TAVR, would you want a cerebral protection device?
Can I just interrupt to make you make the question more realistic?
Okay.
Ask the question, if you ran a cath lab and your hospital administrator said you can either have embolic protection for all the TAVRs in your center or intravascular imaging for all the PCIs in your center, but you can't have both. Which one do you want? Ask a real question. Don't ask a fictitious question about what do you want for your grandmother. ask a question that,
that
is real.
That question is not realistic either.
That's not. That's absolutely realistic.
Not in the U.S.
Ask. I mean, ask the people around this table who are not using it. Why is 80% of the centers in the United States don't use, don't, you know, 80% of the patients in the United States don't get embolic protection in their TAVRs? So clearly, people are making that choice.
But David, I think means, I think you have to look at it other way as well, is patients with high calcium load, valve in valve, patients who are going to require multiple valve manipulations, you can be selective as well. So I think as
so
a clinician...
How many should you use?
But as a clinician, you cannot look at it this way and say, well, you know, if say someone from my family is on the table, I would like to, you know, this embolic protection to be used. It's simple as that.
Mm-hmm. You don't get that choice. Yeah. I mean, you really don't.
No, we do.
You don't. You do not. Ask
what? What do you mean by
that? I'm saying that in the world here, so everybody here does TAVR, put your hand up if you use embolic protection more than 50% of your TAVR procedures.
Yeah. How about flip it the other way around? If the patient comes in and say, I want cerebral protection device, and you say, no, you're going to have it.
I mean, I'm saying that you, I mean, that
you don't.
It is absolutely legitimate to say you know, we have a finite amount of money. That's what, I mean, that's even what Samir said. Samir said his very last line was, if money is no object.
But remember that if the patient asks you for a device and you say you're not going to use it because it is going to cost you money, then, you know, this is a...
No, we can't be doing that. We have to have guidelines to tell us what to do for that.
I know that, but what I'm saying is that it is, that's what it boils down to, that either the administrator or you, but you are together. So you cannot blame your administrator to say that, you know, he didn't give you the money.
Yeah.
So you are going to say that I'm not going to use the device, and then the patient has a stroke.
If you ignore money, everything gets easy.
I think
it is absolutely ludicrous to say that money doesn't matter. How many TAVRs do you guys do a year at Minneapolis Heart?
300,
okay. So you can't figure out something useful to do with $600,000 a year?
I've got a better solution, actually, because this...
Fire the bunch of hospital administrators?
This room is full of cardiologists, but we are not debating why the cost of TAVR should not come down. The cost of TAVR is going up, not coming down. 15 years ago, we were promised that more devices, more choice, cost will come down. If the cost of TAVR comes down, I don't think we should be arguing whether you should use this, whether we should use perclose. I think these are really important things. You know, minimalistic TAVR is based on that. So you all should be arguing about cost of TAVR should come down.
You're having theoretical arguments.
So our debate is not cerebral protection device versus no cerebral protection device.
That's what you just started to ask the question.
I understand, but at the same time, it's no answer. If you talk about money,
In surgery, we don't fight like this, you know.
I'm not fighting. I'm just saying that's why you don't do any surgery.
You can ask the question to the people that if you have aortic stenosis and a good anatomy for TAVR, do you want surgery? At least I don't want surgery. But nobody would want a surgery. That's crazy to have surgery.
But
if you have a good, I think, what is the point of stopping the heart and starting it again and doing opening the chest? You have to recognize that, right?
So
whatever, however good it is, and circular and non-circular and all this, is all...
Yeah. I completely agree. Yeah. But what you're forgetting is in 7 years, you will be on my table for a much higher surgery.
But listen to me.
And
20 years ago, TAVR didn't exist.
Sure.
7 years later, there will be a whole new different game.
Nothing will be new.
On your, oh, no, no.
Nothing
that
will be new.
That is what you think. This is the limitation. But why would you come on your table? I'll go on somebody else's table.
Sure.
But the idea is that people who have better option, that's where you will go, right? You are not going to go to... And so Leonardo da Vinci depicted the valve in 1500. It took 100 years to understand the valve gets narrowed, 1600. It could took 300 years to know that you can replace the valve. 20 years, we got a valve percutaneously replaced. And now 20 years later, it's a standard of care. So the exponential growth, so 7 years, 8 years is a long time. 7, 8 years later, you are going to have options, you know, so many different options.
Like what? So, imagine, use your imagination.
Leaflet modification.
Leaflet modification, valve in valve, preventing and putting a new valve that will last for 20 years. There are so many different things can happen.
20 years, okay.
Why not?
I think if you have a leaflet that is durable.
Durable,
right? Is that? There's no issue.
So
right?
I think no this no fundamentally issue. Shows, and this is no criticism against cardiology community, you all love intervention. I love it as well. It's great. But you have a short-term mentality. I think people talk of leaflet modification. People talk of this doesn't matter, that doesn't matter. Let's not forget that it does matter, actually. And let's not forget that patient has biological valve because they don't want anticoagulation. TAVR in TAVR, most of your patients are going to end up on anticoagulation. So let's not fool ourselves by saying it's okay. I mean, you are doing the same mistakes my predecessors in surgery did by saying TAVR is rubbish. It's not going to work. You know, you don't want to make the same mistake because in 10 years or 8 years' time, I'll stand on the podium and say, you cardiologist said SAVR is rubbish. And I think you all are making the same mistake we did 20 years ago by saying, this actually is never going to work. So I think let's open our eyes. Yeah. And this whole heart team is not just to show on the podium, but this is a robust conversation. And Samir would have surgery in Cleveland, I know.
No. Listen to me.
Nobody dies in Cleveland and nobody gets a stroke in Cleveland.
But listen to me.
And they go home same day.
One very important thing to keep in mind is that there are millions and billions of dollars invested in TAVR. There is almost nothing invested in SAVR. So if you are going to just, this is reality of life. So if you are going to say that there are going to be lot of changes, then something has to change. So the fact that nothing like this was invested in SAVR in last 20 years. So if you are going to invest the cerebral power, money, and all the things we are doing, it is going to change. It has to change.
So if it is so good, and this is my question, why are we changing models every 3 years? If it is so fantastic, you know, we have 6 generations of every valve, so we do not have any handle on what works because XT was amazing. It was God's gift to mankind. And then now we have S3, so everybody stands on podium and says, S3 is amazing because it works. Then some other valve comes and says, this is incredible because it works. By the time the data comes out, we move on to the next generation, and that's the game, actually. So I think if you really want to analyze, start thinking of, will this valve last for patient's lifetime? And if it doesn't, do you have a good strategy for second intervention? And I made it very clear that it's about second intervention. Second intervention has to be less invasive, less morbid, and should not change the survival curve of the patient. And I think TAVR and TAVR is just a promise. You know, we are just saying, can we do it? Sure, you can do it. You know, you see a nail, you can hammer it. But is it good for that patient other than psychologically? Probably not. And we need to, as a scientific community, you know, critically appraise it and not just give message that, oh, it's okay. Actually, you look in detail, it's not okay.
Because of time, I think.
We are out of time.
Let the master.
I just want to say that I totally respect the idea of Vinayak Bapat. You know, the interventional cardiologists should pay attention to what they are proposing to the patient according to their age. And we have to take into consideration that we don't know exactly the life expectancy of the valve and that we cannot say to a patient, you know, no problem. No, we'll put a valve in valve, and after that, you will have a valve in valve in valve, and you will finish your life at 90 years. You know, so I am personally very careful when I am dealing with a young patients. You know, I mean less than 70 years, and it's too easy, you know, to get the approval of the patients for the procedure. You know, they are ready to sign. You know, if you say you won't have surgery, you know, they will sign. They will sign whatever could happen in the future. So we have to be very careful. And personally, I don't know exactly what can the surgeon do, you know, if we have a third restenosis inside the valve-in-valve-in-valve process. Can they remove the valve? Can they do they have to change the aorta? So this is what I wanted to say. I totally approve, you know, the caution that
to have to have according to patient age. Also, I am a little surprised by the fact that Vinayak said that he doesn't understand what we have been improving the valve year after year, you know, because it's clear that the valve that we were implanting at the beginning were not the best in the world, you know, so things had to be improved. And I'm very, very grateful to companies who have been working so much, you know, to make these different generation devices, decreasing all the complications, the pacemaker, the PVL, and this cannot be criticized, you know, and it's not finished. The valve are still improving, and I was really fascinated by the communications on the different valve model that we can use today and that we will use in the future. I think we have to continue to make progress with the valve. As surgeons done with it, you know, they move from the valve, the ball valve, to the bioprosthesis, and then they change the bioprosthesis several times. The same thing, you know.
Thank you. So I'm glad that the Game of Thrones the series is over. So we don't. So next year we'll do the House of Dragons. The debate will be easier. Thank you very much.
Thank you.